Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are the Disco Machine, and we're from Melbourne. And don't get some crazy idea in your head that we're cool, because we're here to make dicks of ourselves tonight.
I present to you Damian Cowell's Disco Machine.
My baby is interested in geopolitics, but I just want to dance. What the fuck? 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 What the fuck?
I like to pretend I'm some kind of producer, but I'm no innovator. When I drop a track, I'm more like a clumsy waiter. I spend hours on end fiddling with audio minutiae. Yet through sheer misuse, this goose lays a golden egg later. One night I was working so long, I somehow flipped a switch that was somehow wrong. And then I, you know, like, dropped the mix. I uploaded 5 minutes of absolutely nothing, total silence. And then I thought, why not leave it up there just for kicks? Called it Damian Cowell's Disco Machine, a post-post-post-postmodernist critique. At least that's what I said when sometime later they interviewed me on Future Music Magazine. But really, it was the first thing that came into my head. I called it Damian Cowell's
Disco Machine.
Damian Cowell's
Disco Machine.
Gave an ass, least of all me. My bullshit lining stayed up there in the cloud. Then, suddenly, hits on me rise exponentially, and I get messaged by someone in Chiaroscuro's crowd. Chiaroscuro, world's hottest DJ, no less. Chiaroscuro, every remix wish list top name. Chiaroscuro, play my silent track at Modern Unconsciousness. She said, music as we know it will never be the same. It was called a Demi Cow.
A
Demi Cow. A Demi Cow. A Demi Cow. What the fuck? The scene. They called it No Step. And soon competing DJs were taunting their rivals to be more extreme. A track by Shandy Warhol called Empire State Build-Up went for one entire day. And Chiaroscuro was the lightning conductor. Her invisible ink tattoos glowing vivid hues only when the lights turned red. I was Chiaroscuro's curio, her one-hit wonder. I was fated, and my sneakers migrated under her bed.
There's a school of thought among certain DJs that when you're listening to silence, vinyl is the only true way. Some built huge systems to enhance the oral abyss. There are 451 subgenres of retro cassette hiss. Some kids danced to their internal groove. Some kids stayed rigid, didn't want to be the first to move. Isolation tanks became the accessory du jour. And all around the world, you could hear a pin drop on the dance floor.
When it hit Cooter and Ibiza, Chiaroscuro said it was beneath her. You know it's over when you hear it on a bank ad. She stopped taking my calls and hit stable with some turntable prodigy from Nepal. I was just a passing fad. No step turned ironic. I was sued by John Cage's estate. Now I stay at home alone, me and all my friends. But that's okay. I got time. I can wait. In 3 years, are you know what, we'll be here again. And there we go. Sneaky air pocket. I might turn up where you least expect. Drop like a summons in your letterbox. Drop chiaroscuro. Sorry, have we met?
So we did this crowdfunding campaign, and it actually went incredibly well. And so. At that point, I realised that I could live out some of my worst fantasies, like having two drummers on stage the entire time. I like the idea of two drummers because there's actually no point to having two drummers. Once you've got one drummer, that's probably, you know, going far enough. But I just like the concept of two drummers. It's just sort of like, you know, eating two Golden Gay Times at once, rather than sort of consecutively.
It was essentially double the amount that I figured out. And I suppose that gave me the, that emboldened me, gave me the sort of over-inflated sense of myself with all that fabulous donation coming in to go, all right, well, perhaps I can have a big band and tour it around and maybe even gave a little bit more lead in my pencil to go and ask all these famous people on board. So, and it's all happened.
Let's list this group of famous people because it's bloody impressive. Let me tell you, let's kick it off. Sean McAuliffe.
Yeah, that's right. Sean McAuliffe, I had met him on the set of Full Frontal or Fast Forward. I can never remember which one it was, but of course I was in a Glow-mesh. I was wearing a Glow-mesh purse at the time.
And that attracted him to you immediately, I guess.
Yeah, but and he was lovely, and he, you know, came around to my house and was a complete professional. And I think I was saying last week at a little gathering to celebrate the release of the album that we are, you know, very, very similar, Sean and I, except, of course, that he's famous and lots of women want to root him.
I hope you enjoy Damian Cowell's Disco Machine.
Jesus Barista, superstar. Jesus Barista, superstar.
Time will be a fine walk in the
sure you know, actually, but I used to be in a band called Tism. We got quite successful quite quickly, and I managed to hide this fact from my mother for 2 to 3 years. And then one day she was on the train and she bumped into Marie Hardy. Now, my mum was a secretary of a girls' Catholic school in Springvale, and Marie Hardy was an ex-student. And she said to my mum, "I saw Damien's band on television." And mum nearly fell out of her seat because the last time I told her we were doing a gig was the Springvale Cricket Club barbecue. Well, that was all fine, except that Marie Hardy then said, "Yeah, they were doing a song called Defecate on My Face." Now, hearing my mother speak the words defecate on my face with a look of hurt and betrayal is not one of those cocaine off a hooker's back kind of things that you dream about when you want to be a rock star. Thank you, Marie Hardy.
Exactly what this dance record would sound like when I started out. I thought perhaps I would just sort of do a electronic dance record and, you know, no one would buy it. In fact, I've done a huge disco album and slightly more people than no one have bought it.
Thank you.
yourself the silent treatment, familiarity. Oh, well, it breeds contempt. My anniversary. To the evil of the world. When me and me woke up over, you guessed it, a girl. Wells said that. No wonder he put on 25 stone. I see these people around me living a life I can only dream of. Happy in their own company because they with the one they love. I wanna be loved by me. I wanna be loved by me.
Ladies and gentlemen, meet Emily Jarrett of Damian Cowell's Disco Machine. Emily Jarrett for us today will demonstrate the difference between violin playing and disco violin playing. First, some violin playing. Thank you, Emily. And now, disco violin playing, which is far more daggy, far more soaring, far more agricultural. Thank you, Emily. And there you see it. Disco music, it's very lowbrow. Goodbye.
And the next song we're going to do is called Folk Music Turns Me Into a Fascist. And I know that you may say to me, well, hang on, aren't you picking on hipsters there? But actually, it's a more of a sort of a personal reason, because when I was at school, my best friend stopped listening to David Bowie, grew a beard, bought an acoustic guitar, stopped wearing shoes, and called himself a folk singer. And it wasn't because of some, you know, affinity with the Dust Bowl troubadour. No, it was this sort of Bill Cosby-esque reason, you see, because he used to take his guitar to parties and serenade girls with it. This was insufferable, right? So I'd be there at a party talking to a pretty young girl, just getting up the courage to ask her out to a movie, you know, like Ryan O'Neill in Love Story or something. And he would push in between us with his acoustic guitar at crushing volume and play these horrifying folk songs like Ross Ryan's Blue Chevrolet,
ballerina. And he'd be looking her in the eyes the entire time. 3 hours of this torture would ensue until eventually the girl would go out behind the garage and perform fellatio on his evil-smelling, gangrenous penis. So I've had a problem with folk music ever since.
morning after the first show. I think we did pretty well. And now, packing of all the crap onto the trolleys commences like Tetris. Sleepy, tired, hungover,
I recently saw the much acclaimed film Birdman, and of course, you know, many of you watching at home tonight will see the parallels between the story of Birdman and Damien Cowell's Disco Machine. This is, in fact, without trying to, you know, do too many spoilers, this is, in fact, my, you know, sort of ill-conceived Broadway comeback in some ways. And like the film Birdman, I do also have this voice all the time in my head going, this smells like balls. You know, that voice is generally in my head whenever I'm not actually performing the rest of the time, which is obviously 99.999 recurring percent. That voice is saying to me, you're shit, give up. However, you know, I'm still here and, you know, perhaps arguably, depending on which way you interpret the ending of the movie Birdman, I am flying above the mundanity of everyday life.
Kate Miller-Heidke.
Thank you.
Primary school, when I went there, you know, when a kid spewed up on the ground, and this happened at least 5 times a day in the playground, they just come along and put a pile of sawdust on top of it, right? So we used to form this circle around this pile of sawdust, like something out of Lord of the Flies, and we'd all be sort of chanting and trying to nudge each other onto it until finally one person would step on this fetid, fly-blown pile of sawdust. And then for the next 5 weeks, we would ostracize them and go, "Ew, you stepped on a spew!" Now that's kind of like what people do to hipsters in Melbourne these days.
John, how did you feel when Damian approached you about this collaboration?
Oh, no, really excited, because TISM were like part of my consciousness, like when I was younger. And they seemed dangerous. This was like before the internet, and so they were just signifiers around Melbourne. Like you'd walk past some poster, and it'd be like one of the, and it'd be like something fearful about it, but not knowing it was a bit of fun.
I'd like to introduce to you my personal spiritual guidance counsellor, my relationship counsellor. This man, along with Public Enemy and Boogie Down Productions, was one of the seminal figures of hip-hop with his band Raspberry Cordial. Ladies and gentlemen, John Safran.
Don't forget the point. Done bad things, it's true. Regrets, I've had a few. But that's nothing compared to things I've said in job interviews.
I never said please when I left the table. I stole my granny's wheels. I parked in the stable.
Thank you.
John Safran.
These two lovely ladies. There's Lil, when she's in focus, she's really gorgeous.
I pretend I can play violin, but I can't.
Oh, yeah. That's awesome. Damien's hired her to make the stage look hotter. Although we do have Em in the band, who's she is one saucy mama.
She looks 25.
She looks 25 and handles like she's 18. So how do you feel about being on stage with the Damian Cowell tonight, ladies?
I'm He's the best!
Yeah.
Freaking out.
Freaking out, yeah. 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 It's pretty exciting. Just look at the man. Look. Polo neck. Polo neck t-shirt.
I always think polo neck's a turtleneck. They both got neck in the same time.
I don't think it's a natural crossover, no, not really, no. It's not, it's certainly not my style of writing, no. So that, yeah. That's why it's fun to do.
You're feeling bad again, December's here. You're looking at the list of friends you haven't seen all year. We must catch up, set another one this week. Your diary's full as a postman's sack, and all you want is sleep. You look about to come unglued, so I thought I'd send this festive wish to you. I hope you get laid for Christmas. Ladies and gentlemen, the fabulous Liz Stringer.
Whiskey at the belly's gonna end in a party. And everyone plays the same CD. I'm overseeing shy. Long leg shopping centers at midnight. And you're feeling
they have to surprise you, and they do, but not in the way they intend to. So you're left with a ceramic wombat, a whole guillotine quilt, a garden hose, a goat, and a dose of middle class guilt. So here you are with relatives you wouldn't normally choose. Sizzling heat, sibling resentment, or simply too much booze. Your sister's always gotta be
her husband's a jerk.
He don't eat meat,
he's on turkey.
And I hope you get laid for Christmas. I hope you get laid for Christmas. Liz.
Damian, I don't know if I've given you my musical credentials. I'm a member of APRA, but I only have, there's only one tune for which I still get royalties. Seriously, it's called Ship Music. and this is, I can actually perform it for you now. It's on a Degeneration album, and it simply goes, Shit Music, 23 FM. And that song is registered with APRA. There's a card for it in their system. And I get a check for like 28 cents every 8 years.
You should think of, you know, putting that in the Vander and Young Songwriters competition. You never know.
It's your brand, your mission, your vision.
You might think change me opportunity.
There's you, bass drum, from the sheer face of life's decision.
Your world is one red TAD.
Except no butts and the pop plants, and no one's a track pass.
You might be all that, but no, don't heck of a safety cat. No, don't. Cat, you're in and a bit, there's no doubt about that. But no, don't, heck to the safety cat. The neighborhood's been gentrified.
You reckon it's not so gritty? Working class factor.
As you write your blog, my city's dying.
Based on the views of you and your friends, who are all writers and actors.
You might just be a little snide
about the suburban tundra in its alien wonder.
But there's one caveat. No, don't hack up a safety cat. No, don't hack up a safety cat. Where you where it's at, but no, don't hack double safety cat. Works three ways, it crosses the street. The safety cat works a job it hates, just to make it fit. The safety cat doesn't stay up late, cause it needs to sleep. But there's no beaten path as that, the winter leads the critic to the safety cat. Well, you might think suburbia is surreal. You might think he's a hamster on a wheel. Work a drone who cannot dig the field. But I say, physician, heal thyself. You too, follow rules. There's nothing as conservative as cool. Walk straight across the road.
Don't run.
You heard it. Don't run.
This is actually what you spend most of your time doing. Most of your time doing. Most of your time doing. Most of your time doing when you're in a band. That is filming other people doing all your luggage work for you.
Yes, there's clearly a petition going around to have TISM involved in Australia's Eurovision quest.
What's the chances out of 10 of that happening?
Well, look, you know, it's a lovely meme, Lindell. It's a lovely idea, and it's a fabulous thing that people can joke about, but you really don't want TISM at Eurovision, even if TISM...
I don't think that's true. Well, that's what they need.
Oh, maybe, yeah, but no, I don't want to I don't want to pour water on their little fire there or anything, but Tism aren't going to get back together, not even for Eurovision.
Not even for Eurovision. No. You've heard it first, folks. Yeah. It ain't happening.
Look, Steve, I think really what should happen is that the members of Tism should sit at home on their couches and watch imposters wearing the outfits perform at Eurovision. I'd be quite happy with that.
It's a bit like Daft Punk, isn't it?
Yeah,
I quite really know
well,
whether
I've
it's...
Well, I've heard that about them. But no, I'd love to see... people go on as Tism and totally wreck the legacy, you know? just bend over and obey to every Eurovision dictating so that, you know, all these young kids will go, gee, that Tism, they're a bit shit, you know? My big brother reckons they were good, but what a bunch of corporate lackeys they are.
Jesus, barista, superstar. Jesus, barista, superstar. Barista, superstar. Jesus, barista, superstar. He tried photography,
but he was no good.
He tried filmmaking,
but he wasn't good.
He worked in retail,
but was not persistent.
'Cause in retail,
he's sharp assistant.
He joined a band,
but he gave it away 'cause
after 3 weeks,
ladies at White Night, and thank you guys for making me laugh.
We should put that in the bell.
I'm heading out to some director this weekend to try and spot a few rock stars hiding behind vending machines.
Sounds like well done, Groovers.
Very fun. Oh, easy
sorry, come up and
oh, fuck, look at that level. Yeah.
Did you miss
it? Just in the middle of it, I went, yay!
And out.
Whew, that was brutal.
Hello, I'm Sam and this is Julia.
Hello.
We are here because we are big fans of Damian. Surname?
Cowell.
Cowell. and his work and everything he's done. Mm-hmm. So we're happy to be here. Go buy the record.
Yeah.
I think we get royalties.
Did you get paid?
No.
And now, a touching scene involving chickens.
God dare you touch me.
This is what guitarist Gordon Blake does when he goes to the airport. Champagne, beluga caviar, and Russian prostitutes.
It was weird anyway, because it was like having a character from television come into your house, you know. I was wearing a neatly pressed white t-shirt and clean jeans, and Tim came in sort of looking like a rock star in the middle of a Saturday afternoon. So in every way he fulfilled my darkest fantasy that he's not like me on the weekends and just dresses up to go out on a Saturday night. He's actually Tim Rogers the whole time.
24/7.
Yeah.
Tim, how did you feel when Damian approached you about this collaboration?
Tumescent.
I don't know, is Tim Rogers here?
I went in the Vander and Young songwriting competition. I wrote a song about writing songs. I thought, you know, why don't I write a song about writing songs? It's sort of meta of me. But then after I wrote it, I thought, you're a fuckwit. And so I canned that totally. And I decided I'd write a song about a catamite. Now, I'm not sure if you know what a catamite is. A catamite is a boy who's kept for the purposes of sodomic sexual intercourse by an older man. Now, this was quite popular back in the ancient Greek days. I don't think it's quite the practice these days, although I hear that, you know, there's an urban myth that Liberace kept young Talentine star Jamie Redfern as his catamite. I also heard that the mining industry kept Tony Abbott as their catamite. But anyway, I thought, yeah, what the judges of the Vander and Young songwriting competition really want to hear is a song about catamites. In fact, a song about ancient Greek myths concerning catamites. So I wrote a song about Ganymede. Now, Ganymede was a catamite in ancient Greek mythology, and Ganymede was the catamite for the god Zeus. So I thought I'd write a song, and it would kind of go like this. Ganymede cooked his goose when he caught the eye of Zeus. He wanted to be a train driver, but he ended up as the caboose. 'Cause it's not cool for catamites. Strangely, I didn't actually win the Vander and Young songwriting competition that year. Anyway, so ashamed as I am of that song, I thought I might play for you now the song I was originally going to put up for the Vander and Young songwriting competition. It's a song about writing a song. It's called The Future Sound of Nostalgia.
Fuck you with seal of green. Perception is reality at school, so it's a theme. One day at 10 years on, she'll come up on that song and laugh at just how wrong her so-called Facebook friends have been. 'Cause the quiet one wins in the end, and that song will be her friend. Will you love me tomorrow? Will you love me? Track it on this mixtape. Headphone boy could take or leave, but fate will legislate that she walks in like a cool breeze. And now that song will forever sing of her. Her eyes and her perfect skin and her cool way will stay with him after she breaks away from him. In time, a heart can mend, and that song will be his friend. To be someone. Someone's in the air. What a wonderful day to be. Will you love me tomorrow? Will you love me? A starlet all over the radio. DJ with two turntables and a microphone. Go to a song's internal world when things aren't good. good at home. Some boys will play that noise, 'cause it tells them they're not alone. Who cares if it goes to your feet, or to your heart, or to your head? Like whistling when darkness sends, a song could be your friend. To be someone's friend. Forget about famous. Are you someone's friend? Forget about famous. Playlist, are you someone's friend? To be someone's, to be someone's, to be someone's friend. To be someone's friend. To be someone's in the air. Tomorrow.
I would like us to come back. It's obviously going to take a lot of money again, and that's a bit depressing, but you know, fingers crossed, the Birdman-like voice in my head won't win out, and Damien Cowell's Disco Machine, you won't have heard the last of us yet.
You know, I've had the silliest week. I've been just sort of bombarded by texts and Facebook posts and tweets about some guy who started some petition or something. And, you know, I don't know what it was about. It was like, you know, if we get enough signatures, Palestine and Israel will get along, or, you know, if we get enough signatures, Bill Cosby will date someone who's awake. And, you know, my phone was ringing all day, and I even got a call from MX magazine. Can you believe it? MX magazine rang me up. So I returned the call, and there was this chimp on the end of the line, and just sort of went, I said, I'm a serious artist and I expect you to change your editorial approach to suit my style. And they went, I said, I think at least a two-page spread going into each song individually and talking about the deeper meaning behind the lyric. And they went, and I heard all these typewriters clanking in the background. And then GTV Channel 9 rang me up and they went, I said, could I speak to someone who doesn't work in marketing? And then I spoke to a person doing programming and they said, we'd like Kism to reform and do a song. A song for our new series featuring Blake from The Bachelor. It's called I Seem Like a Cunt, but really I'm a fucking cunt.
Be a man.
Thanks, everyone. See you again, maybe. Okay.